This right here is my favorite drink in the whole world. It's called a coffee frostino. It's ice cold. And this here is my second favorite drink. It's called a cafe latte and it's red hot. So let's see what happens when I mix my two favorite drinks together. Yeah, not gonna lie, that tastes pretty disgusting. You see, the lukewarm Christian, he's not ice cold, he's not away from God, but at the same time, he's not red hot on fire for God. He's just lukewarm, and the Bible says, because you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. Isaiah 29 verse 13 says this, because this people say they are mine, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. So what you're about to watch now is going to be the most controversial video I have ever made on this channel, because today I am making this video for one type of believer, and that's the lukewarm Christian. That's the man, that's the woman, who when they go to church, they say the right things, they act the right way, but when they're with their non-Christian friends, when they're alone, they're a completely different person. Now, before we go any further, I want to make something abundantly clear. You see, Christianity is different to every other religion. All the other religions say, do this, do that, do this. But Jesus says, no, it's done. On the cross, I cried out, it is finished. Romans 5 verse 1 says, those who put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, they are declared righteous. So in other words, you and I, we've got this massive debt to pay. Am I the only one who's a rotten sinner? Is there anyone else watching this who's a filthy, rotten sinner like me? We've got this huge debt to pay, but the second you put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, he deposits all of his spiritual riches into your bank account, so you become a spiritual millionaire like that, all because of the Lord Jesus Christ. So at no point in this video am I saying we need to earn our way to heaven. We need to put off the flesh in some way that we can achieve our salvation, because it's already been achieved in Christ. But here's the real reality, the raw truth is this. Your sin has consequences. You can choose the sin, but you can't choose the consequence. And today I want to give you five consequences to your rebellion against the Holy God. Number one. God will discipline you. Hebrews 12 verse 6 says this, for the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. You need to know one thing about me. I went through a really painful experience. And I remember in the darkest hour, I screamed out to God. In my heart, I was crying out, why God? Why have you allowed this to happen to me? And God replied with just three words. It wasn't audible, but these three words were so solid in my spirit, I cannot deny it was not the voice of the Lord. He said these three words, you know why. You know why this has happened, Joe. And I knew within an instant that God was chastising me for an ongoing sin that I had been committing for years and years. My dear brother, my dear sister, God is dangerous, and if you are a child of God, he will discipline you, he will chastise you, he will humble you. If you are wandering from the fold, if you are wandering from the nest, God will cut you down, and sometimes he'll hurt you badly to bring you back to that place of holiness, to bring you back to that place where you are close to his son, because you matter so much to him. I'll never forget what my granddad once said to me as a teenager. He said, Joe, we've forgotten the solemnity of God. What does that mean? It means we've forgotten that God is a holy, reverent God. We call him the Almighty, not the Almighty. God is love, but just like a good father will discipline his children when they wander, when they do wrong, so this Almighty God will discipline us if we run from him, if we disobey him, if we act like a child of the world, like a child of the devil. God will cut us down sometimes and it will hurt. Now, please don't misunderstand me. Every time something bad happens to you in your life, don't think this is a punishment from God. Don't always think this is God disciplining me for a sin. Do you remember Job? Righteous Job. He was one of the most righteous men on earth. He loved God, he obeyed God, and yet God allowed everything to be lost in a day. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the most godly, the man who had never sinned, He walked on this earth, was spat on, was mocked, had a crown of thorns, was scorned, was laughed at. All of his friends deserted him. He went through tremendous pain, certainly not because he'd done anything wrong. Sometimes God just allows the righteous to suffer to bring glory to his name. Do you remember once Jesus was walking with his disciples and they noticed in front of them was a blind man begging on the street? And the disciples asked him, "Teacher, who sinned? Was it the blind man who caused himself to be blind, or was it his parents who sinned?" And Jesus' response was so telling. He said, "Neither. No, rather, this man is blind, so that the work of God might be displayed through him." So every time something bad happens to us, every time we fall ill or an accident or something happens, don't always jump to the conclusion that God is chastising me for a sin. So, how do we know when we are being disciplined by God? Well, do you remember when Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers? And then years and years go by, Joseph is now the president. He's like the most powerful man in Egypt. And his brothers arrive before Joseph and they can't tell that it's their brother that's standing in front of them. And Joseph deals roughly with the brothers. What do the brothers say? They say this: "This is because we sold our brother Joseph into slavery. Now we're being punished for this years and years later." They knew within an instant that God was dealing with them. And so I think it happens to us. If we are being chastised by the Lord God, I think we'll have a sort of certainty in our hearts knowing, yes, this is the hand of God bringing me down onto my knees, bringing me down to a place of prayer to humble me so that I might be more like his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The second consequence of lukewarm Christianity is you will reap what you sow. Galatians 6 verses 7 to 8 say this: "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap eternal life." What I'm about to tell you next will blow your brains out. Do you remember Jacob in the Bible? He was smooth-skinned and his brother Esau was hairy. He was an older brother, so he would rightfully receive the blessing from his father Isaac. And when the day of the blessing happened, Esau was sent out into the field to go and get some food. But Jacob snuck in and he put on the garments, he put on the fur of a kid, of a goat, and he said, "I am your son Esau, bless me." He deceived his father Isaac with the garments. And then when Jacob got older, he had some children of his own. And one of his children was called Joseph, who he loved so dearly. And he gave Joseph this beautiful garment, this wonderful technicolor dream coat, which had all these beautiful colors on it. But one of his brothers, Judah in particular, was very, very jealous of Joseph. So he threw Joseph into a pit and he left him to be sold into slavery. And then he took the garments, he covered it in animal's blood and said, "Your son Joseph has been killed by a wild animal, Jacob." He deceived Jacob with a garment. And then, do you remember in Judah's life, Judah lost his wife and he was so depressed, he was so low, that he went into the town, into the Canaanite area, and he looked for a prostitute. And there was his daughter-in-law, who was also a widow, who was also bereaved, and she wanted children of her own. So she dressed up as a prostitute, and she slept with her father-in-law. She deceived Judah with a garment. Can you see that pattern that's happened? You reap what you sow. And so it is in our lives. If we will sow out these seeds of the flesh, often we'll reap a harvest of our own sin. You can't deny that the Bible is true. We're seeing a lot of scandals coming forth in the news. Men who years and years ago committed sins, dark sins in the past, and they thought they got away with it. But the harvest came. They reaped what they sowed. They thought it was done, it was in the past. But God will not be mocked. The Bible says anything which is hidden will one day be exposed. So I plead with you, brothers and sisters in Christ, be so, so careful what seeds you plant today, tomorrow, next week, in the coming years, because whatever seeds you plant which are sinful, one day they'll grow up, they'll sprout, and you'll reap a harvest of your sin. And consequence number three, pointless prayer. What I'm about to say next is incredibly controversial. But did you know this? Sometimes prayer can be a total waste of time. Listen to Proverbs 28 verse 9. If one turns away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is an abomination. And then Psalm 66 verse 18 says this, if I had cherished iniquity, that sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Do you understand what those verses are saying? Those verses are saying that if we rebel against God, if we ignore God's commands, if we just go our own way, then God will say, okay, I'm not going to listen to your prayers for the time being. Until you obey me, until you follow after me, until you come to me with a contrite heart, begging and pleading for forgiveness, until you repent, I don't want to hear what you've got to say. That sounds harsh, doesn't it? But let me put it another way to you. I want you to imagine that I'm your servant right now. And you tell me, Joe, I want you to deliver a parcel on number 23 of my street. So I say, okay, thanks for giving me that job, I'll do it. You ring me up the next day. Joe, have you delivered the parcel to 23? No, I've not yet. You ring me up next week. Joe, have you delivered the parcel to 23? Sorry, I haven't got round to it yet. I'm sorry about that. You do it in a month's time. Joe, have you managed to deliver that parcel to number 23? I'm sorry, I haven't. What's going to happen if I continually just ignore what you're asking me to do? Well, eventually you're going to say, Joe, I can't trust you anymore. I'm not going to give you any commands. I'm not going to ask you to do anything anymore. And so it is with you and I. As Christians, if we constantly shut out God's commands, God's warnings that we hear in sermons, that we hear in the Word of God, if we completely close our ears, God's going to eventually stop speaking into our lives and we're going to drift away from the God that we love. But then, on the flip side, however, remember this, God blesses obedience. In the book of James it says, the prayer of one righteous man availeth much. So in other words, if you are obeying God, if you're in close fellowship with Him, sometimes God can do mighty things through you. You pray a prayer and He answers it and you're blown away by it. Wow, this Almighty God is hearing my prayers. And it's because He's blessing the obedience of His son, of His daughter. Number four, we ruin our witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. If I asked you, who is your favourite Bible character in the whole of the Bible? Who would you say? Do you know who my favourite character is? It's Jonah's sea captain. Do you remember when Jonah's, he ran away from what the Lord had told him to do, and he got on a boat to Tarshish, and here this big storm came because he'd rebelled against the Lord. And all the sailors are praying to their false gods, and of course nothing had happened, the storm had carried on. So the sea captain went down to the lower deck where Jonah was fast asleep, and he said, arise, O sleeper, pray to your God that perhaps he might hear our prayer and turn away this dreadful storm from the ship. What was happening there? Here was this unbeliever, here was this ungodly man, and he's rebuking the man of God, telling him what to do. That's so interesting because that can happen to us very, very often. Am I the only one who's laughed at a rude joke in the workplace? Am I the only one who said something wrong and a non-believer said, Joe, I thought you were meant to be a Christian. I thought you were meant to follow God. Why are you laughing at that? Why are you acting like that? Does that ever happen to you? My mother-in-law is a lovely lady, but she's not born again. And not so long ago, she really did convict me. She said, Joe, you're so anxious about getting this illness, about catching that, but you're going to heaven. And according to your beliefs, I'm not. So why is it I'm not worried, but you are? And I thought, wow, wow, she's got some truth there. You see, what we need to remember is, when we are living our life, the whole world is watching you. The whole world is watching to see if this Christianity, if this Jesus is really as precious as you say is. Because you preach Him, you read your Bible, you say to people, come to Christ, you'll get peace, you'll get joy, you'll get a hope beyond the grave. So do you really believe this message? Or are you just going to not practice what you preach? So when we sin, when we fret, when we're anxious, when we live in habitual sin, people are watching, they're listening, and it's ruining the witness of our blessed Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. And some people, sadly, they say, I'll never become a Christian because there's so many hypocrites in Christianity. And we can get angry and we can get bitter at them for saying that. But actually, I think sometimes we need to look at our own hearts, because revival only starts in the church when the believers of God get together and say, wow, we need to repent of sin. We need to look at ourselves and say, God, how can you bless us when we're so rebellious against you? And the fifth consequence of lukewarm Christianity is you could lose rewards. Listen to Matthew chapter 25, verse 23. It says this: His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Guys, can I ask you, do you believe that we'll have jobs to do in the new creation? I mean, I don't think we'll just be sort of sat on a cloud, twiddling our thumbs, thinking, yeah, this is great, we're in heaven now, no pain, no suffering. I think God is going to give us jobs and work to do. And what we do in this life has eternal consequences. It matters forever. So God has given us all responsibilities. Some of us have spouses. Some of us have children. Some of us have jobs. We've all got a gospel that we need to be obedient and share with other people. And God will look at all of our responsibilities, at all of the things He's entrusted to us, and say, okay, you did this with the 70, 80 years I give you in this life. Here's your job for all of eternity. That's what you're going to be trusted with. And that's why it really does matter to be obedient. That's why it matters to follow after Jesus Christ and not to be lukewarm and to have one foot in the world and one foot in Christ's kingdom. We need to be on fire for God, because then He'll give us more. Those who are trusted with little will be given much more in the kingdom of God. Just like David was entrusted with a few little lambs, and later he was entrusted to be the king of Israel. Just like Joseph was thrown into prison unjustly, and he was entrusted to look after the prisoners. Later, he would become the most powerful man in Egypt. So you and I were entrusted with these small things, that one day we might be given greater, greater responsibility from the Lord God. And that really, really excites me to hear those words. Well done, good and faithful servant. I long for that. Do you? There is one final thing that I would be very, very sad if you walked away from this video and didn't remember this. Holiness equals happiness. The most miserable man, the most miserable woman on earth is the lukewarm Christian. Why is that? Because they can't enjoy their sin, because the Holy Spirit is convicting them that this is wrong, and they're grieving the Spirit of God who indwells inside them. But at the same time, they can't enjoy the Lord Jesus Christ because they're running to this sin. And it's like this polluted pool with clean water and dirty water. And it just makes the person so miserable and so sad. But the person who is on fire for God, the person who obeys God, they have the joy of the Lord. Read the Psalms, read the Proverbs. That word repeats over and over again. Blessed is that man who obeys the Lord. Blessed is that man who walks in the counsel of the Lord. And that word blessed is another word to say happy. So if you follow the Lord God, you will be happy. And that's the thing I ask every single one of us to do. I've preached this message to you, but I've preached it to myself also. If you'd like to hear an even stronger message on being a lukewarm Christian, please do click here. And if you haven't yet joined this family and subscribed, please do so by clicking here. God bless you all, and thank you for listening.